Once you start the commander, this is how your graphical user interface would look like. So before we delve into the creation of listeners, let's get a bit of understanding of the UI itself. Whenever you log in for the first time, this is what you would see. You would see the event logs over here in the front of you, where you would see new connections coming in or any settings that have been changed. You would see the last web activity over here. Whenever a third party or a non-badger connects back to your listener, this is where you would see the metadata of that specific request. Now, remember that this only shows you the latest web activity or the last web activity. To get a full detail about that, you would have to go to the server and take a look at the logs option. On the right-hand side, we have Scratchpad, Command Queue, Warmongers, and Chatbox. Chatbox is a place where you can chat with the other users that are connected to your specific server. Your Warmongers are basically nothing but your users which are connected back. Right now, there's just one. I can go to Warmongers tab, click on Add Warmonger, and add, let's say, maybe a new user. For example, Chetan, and password as, let's say, Chetan at 123. Once this has been added, other users within your organization who are planning to use BrewTotal or planning to do the same red team activity, they can connect back and to the same server using the new username and password in this manner. And once the user has logged in, they would see other users as well over here. I'll close this for the time being. You can add new command and control centers over here directly as a tab in new connections here. I am just keeping this as empty for the time being because I don't need that specifically, but you can take a look at these over here as well. You can also delete your existing Warmongers by going to the delete Warmonger, selecting the specific Warmonger that you want and deleting that specific user. You have a command queue here, which shows you all the latest commands that are pending for the badgers to connect back and take up from the server. Right now it's empty because there are no badgers over here and we have not sent any commands to them. And you have a scratch pad, which is basically a multitasking utility. You can click on the edit option and type in whatever you want and just click on this. So this will basically be saved in memory of over here itself. Remember that it doesn't store anything to disk. It will only store it in memory, and this is just for taking quick notes or viewing any other information. You can click here to view all the, to clear up all the commands that are already there. You have a quick PS exec viewing option. Whenever you perform any kind of lateral movement or PS exec, the service that you create, you will be creating on the basis of this information that you have. This can be changed by going to the C4 profiler, clicking on the PS exec config, and typing a new service name and a new description. By default, this is the service name and description that the server would use to create a service executable whenever you drop a service executable to disk and create a new service for moving laterally over SMB or TCP or something else. I'll clear this again. And then you have a quick view server configuration option, which will show you the username and password of the admin and the other metadata or configuration for your server that you have. So right now, it's mostly empty and you won't see a lot of things here because we have not done anything. Let's get started by creating a quick listener here. I'll go to C4 Profiler and click on Add Listener. The name is auto-populated here. The listener bind host is where your listener would, or I won't say specific to listener, where your Go server or the Rattle server that we started, this is where it would start listening on the internal IP of your server that you have. Right now, I have multiple virtual network addresses as well as my base IP address. I'll use that. If you're someone like me who uses a lot of rotational host or domain fronting, this is where your rotational host would go to. In case you're using multiple hosts, you can type them. For example, you can type abc.com, def.com, xyz.com, and so on. So whenever you create a payload, this is where the payload would connect back to and not to your bind host, because your rotational hosts are supposed to forward whatever data you have to the bind host. If you're just going to use a single domain, you can type in the domain name here. If you're going to use an IP address, you can type in the IP address. Or if you're going to use a domain-fronted system, something like Azure or Fastly or StackPath, then you can add those rotational hosts here. If you're using domain fronting, remember to add the host header over here as well. Right now, I'll just click on same because I'm using a local network. So my bind host and my external host, basically the place where my Badger would connect back, would be the same. You can type in the port here, the user agent, the host header, the extra headers here. The extra headers would go in a key colon value and comma separated format. For example, it would be something like cookie colon test hyphen JWT, comma, then you can go to the next line and then you can type something else again. For example, referrer, for example, and you can type in whatever referrer you have and so on. You can take a look at this later on when we create the C4 profile. You can add multiple URIs here and they will be comma separated. So remember that whenever you're adding any specific URI, there are no commas between the URIs that you're planning to add. So basically, if your URIs are, for example, like something, something, for example, login.php, so you can type slashes or anything that you want, but make sure that whenever you type a comma, this whole single URI becomes one URI. That's basically because comma is used to separate or split different URIs that you specify here. Right now, I'll just type login, comma, admin, comma, test. You can add as long URI as you want. There is literally no limitation because whatever data that you specify, it gets converted to shellcode, and that shellcode is sent back to as a parameter on stack to your Badger shellcode, and that's what gets read by the Badger shellcode. You have the operating system, which is currently limited to Windows, but there will be soon be an option to add a Linux or basically to create a Linux payload as well. SSL, whether to enable it or not. And then you have a common authentication and a one-time authentication option. So if you create a common option or basically a common auth, then whenever your payload would connect back, all the payloads that you create would use the same authentication keys. And whenever they connect back, they would connect back to the server using the same authentication key every time. This means if you are doing a phishing activity and if a member of Blue Team gets a hold of your payload, and if the payload is executed over and over again, that which means that if a payload is executed for more than one time, every time the payload is executed within a sandbox, the payload would be able to connect back because the payload would send back the authentication key, the server would validate it, it would send back a token, and after that, the payload would use that token to connect back every time. But in case of one-time authentication, the payload can only connect back the first time, which means if you execute a payload, the payload connects back to the server would validate the authentication key, delete the authentication key from the server. So if the payload connects back to the server again, the payload would never be able to connect back because if the payload is killed and connected, that's what I mean, not the same payload, because whenever a payload is executed, it sends an authentication key, gets a token, and uses that token to authenticate for any future request. If you're using one-time authentication, if the payload is connected back, let's say by the user for the first time by executing it through a phishing payload, the payload gets connected. Great. The server, the key would be deleted and the payload would basically get an authentication token. And all future requests by the same Badger until the process is killed will use the authentication token. But let's say a Blue Teamer gets a hold of your one-time auth payload and the Blue Teamer tries to execute it within a sandbox or a virtual machine, they won't be able to execute that because it wouldn't connect back to the server. And you would see that over here on the last row activity portion. So we can take a look at this right now by creating a one-time authentication. And later on, we will create a full common authentication, which we'll use for most of our activities. So right now, you can type in whatever password that you want here for your payload authentication. Or if you want to create a random authentication, just click on the select option. Click on the number of keys that you want to create. If you're going to create 10 different payloads create 10 different authentication keys. So I'll set 10 for the time being. I'll click on save. I'll clear this. I can right-click, click on the listener actions, and click on view authentication. And you can see all the authentication keys that are available for your payload. Now, I will copy this. I'll maybe start a quick notepad, and I'll paste all the keys here. These are our keys. I will go and create a new payload, an x64 payload in an exe format. Okay, I'll save it to my documents directory. I'll copy this path. That's where my payload lies. I will go back here and I will quickly execute the payload that I have here. Once executed, I should get a connection back, as you can see, and a notification here. And now, if I right-click, go to X64, go to Listener Actions and click on View Authentication, remember that one of the keys from over here, whichever our payload used, would be removed from the server. As you can see, the primary key that was used is now removed, and we don't have the key that starts with JED8, JE8DM3, and so on. Basically, it means that payload has been removed. And right now, if let's say we go back to our UI, when I say UI, I simply mean our Windows. If I right-click on the Badger, if I terminate it, and if I go back and execute the same payload again, let's say, I won't be able to connect back. As you can see, there is no new authentication. And you can see here that every few seconds, it's updating, and the payload is trying to connect back by sending a post request to our test or login path that we have. And you can go to the server, click on View Logs, go here, click on the deauthentication logs, or the web log, and you would see all the activities for the connection that is being trying to connect. It simply means that the payload is just a dead connection, and it won't be able to connect back to the server. So right now, let's go back and get a normal connection back for our command and control center. So I'll go here, I'll kill the, and before I do that, let me show you how the listener configuration would look like right now. As you can see, we have a Badger configuration. We have a bit of a metadata about the dashboard that you can see over here on the right-hand side bottom. We have the listeners option and a full detailed information about all your C2 keys for your listener. And you can simply click on the auto save disabled option, and it would save this directly to your system. As you can see, the C4 profile has been updated. And if I go to the same directory now, there will be a file named as C4 profile that is now created. And if I try to open that file, as you can see, all the information that we created, added while creating the listener or while doing anything else, all of them have been saved back over here. You can see the listener authentication key has also been changed, except from the one from the payload profiler, the key is now a different one. We'll take a look at the payload profiler later on. And now, you should be able to use the exact same profile to start back your command and control center. So if we go back, let me kill the listener here. Okay. And let me kill the server here as well. Let me clear all the logs. And now what I can do is I can type -retail-c, and we have the C4 profile file here. So we can simply specify that. And you can see that one user, one listener, and your listener configuration as well as your handler has been started. So if I start back and if I go back to our command and control center with the same old username and password, I should be able to see the listener is up and running. We should have all the other information requested. If you wanted to specify a Badger, you could have specified that from the logs directory that we had where the Badger's configuration is eventually stored. So right now, we'll go back, and in the next video, we will take a look at different payload profiles that we can create and the C2 profile or the C4 profile.conf that we have.